Blender aficionados, this is the sixth tutorial that I have ever created. I would like to talk today about how to create an animated texture on your object. We already worked on how to create a box, how to texture a box in a kind of realistic way, and now I am gonna talk about a more advanced technique to create what you can see now. My name is Daniele and I am a 3D artist. I work mainly with Blender and let's go. We have our model that we created in the past tutorials. I am switching between render view, other kind of view. And we start with the texture that we already had. As you can see, the texture is divided into roughness and diffuse. We duplicate the diffuse with Shift D and we load in each duplicate a different kind of texture that we already created in the past. Basically, we have for this box different textures of different colors that are arranged in the same way using the same UV map. What we would like to do is making sure that we can create a transition between each of these textures in such a way we can animate the texture directly in Blender without having to load a different texture created with a video. Basically, you can load videos in Blender, but in that way you need to sync the video with your animation. This technique allows you to move the texture directly on your 3D model. At the moment, we have the white texture that is connected to the diffuse socket of our principal BDSI shader. We start creating a color ramp. You just need to press Shift A inside of the shader editor and then go into Converter Color Ramp. The idea is that the color ramp doesn't really create a nuance here, but allows you to mix different kind of textures. So you don't really use to create just shades of colors, but also to mix different textures. And this is what we are gonna do now. After we create our color ramp, we set the interpolation between color stops to constant, and we create a difference of colors that goes from black to white. After that, we press Shift A, we go into color and we add a mix RGB node. What this node does, it takes two different colors and it has two sockets, color 1 and color 2, and it mixes them. If you don't add a factor, the colors are mixed, creating an average between the two of them, depending on how much you increase the small number at the top. So basically you have a number that goes from 0 to 1, that can be considered 0% to 100%, and it mixes the two colors accordingly. We created the color ramp because in this way we can use it as a mixing factor. What we do, we create several color ramps that show all of them a little bit more of black. You can test it visually because in this very case is the best option. We also need to add a controller and a texture coordinate node. What we do, we use the controller object to check where the texture is gonna be placed. So in the texture coordinates node, you select your controller, then you connect it to the color ramp, to each of the color ramps. So a socket, an outgoing socket, can share different ingoing sockets. So as you can see, now I am testing the various colors on my box. The more you move your color ramp, the more you can alter the colors. Now, this can be a passage that it's a little bit time expensive because you can actually test them. You can decide the amount of colors. In this very case, my box, my brand colors, my brand color is gray. The background is gray. So what I did, I wanted the gray to be the most important color. Moving the control object, you will see that the projection of your map on your object will change depending on the position of the control object. Note that you can actually scale the control object if you want, and scaling it is the equivalent of scaling the map in using a node. You can add a mapping node under vector, so shift A vector. The mapping node allows you to move, rotate, scale your map, your texture. And in this very case, we use the object, the controller object, to do exactly the same. What I did after is adding a math node. You can find it under converter. So shift A, converter, math node. What the math node does is doing math, basically. In this case, I added a modulo math. The modulo multiplies your math. If you have a procedural map, like in this very case, and you want to repeat it, what you have to do is adding a modulo. The module, correct me please. The module allows you to, depending on the number, and in here as well, you need to do some experimentation. To do this, you just need to place it between the socket that checks the texture coordinates and basically what comes after. What I did after was just moving my object forward. I went into animation nodes. Now, animation nodes, they made me notice, and I'm really sorry that in previous tutorials I assumed that everyone had animation nodes installed, but it's not the case. Animation nodes is an add-on and allows you to work with position, scale, rotation, duplication of any object. Is a very powerful instrument. I advise you to have on your computer. I'm gonna post the link on the description of the video anyway. You don't really need to use animation nodes for this. What you have to do is just moving your control object. And after you do it, you will see that the map is repeated infinitely depending on the module that you applied. Another thing, I added another camera. I will probably post a tutorial sooner or later on how to do camera animation. I tend to be quite precise in what I do, and this is one of the reasons why I started to do these tutorials as well. I needed to do stuff in a way that allows me to create a product, but not being extremely precise, because if you are too much precise, you don't finish what you're doing. No one is ever 100% happy with his final product. So, as a friend of mine says, finished but not perfect. And this is the case of my tutorials. What I want is just giving you suggestions that you can use for your projects. I found a lot of tutorials in the past that helped me to develop my skills, and maybe I was taking a piece of information that I could find in one of them and then apply on my project, and in this way I did what I do. In this way I developed my skills. What I do when I animate usually is connecting my cameras to null objects. So in this way, I can use the null object as a pivot point of rotation of my camera, and I can actually move the null object to move the camera. To connect something, you simply select your first object, then you select the final object, so you can connect multiple objects like cameras, different cameras and so on. In this case, I select my camera, I select my null object, and I press Ctrl P. And I always suggest to set the parent, keeping the transformation. So the object that's gonna be linked to the other object will not move depending, will not move in the moment you will apply the connection. It will move later. Basically, they are parent and child. So if you move the parent, the child moves together with the parent. After that, animating is quite simple in Blender. When you put keyframe, you press I. So with your camera selected, you go in the desired frame, you press I, you set a keyframe for rotation, scale, position. Then you move to the next frame and you do the same. If you animate using a null object, like in this case, you will have to apply frames both on your camera and on your object, depending on what you want to do. So if the camera moves toward the object, basically you set a keyframe for the first position and then you set a keyframe for the last position of the camera. And if in the meantime the null object rotates, like this very case, what you have to do is apply the rotation keyframes for your null object. I always try to test my animation in solid preview, in material preview, just to see the final effect. Also, if you press the icons on the left of the previous types, that's called show overlays, you will remove your overlays. And this can be really helpful to see how the final product will appear. I hope you enjoyed the tutorial, and if you liked it, please subscribe to my channel and put a like to the video. This will really help me to grow my channel and reach more people and improve the quality of my tutorials. And also, if you have suggestions, please write me. I had a great suggestion from one of the viewers that allowed me to understand that I gave for granted that animation notes was already pre-installed in Blender. Actually, I have been using it for such a long time that, yeah, I gave for granted that. In any case, I am planning to work on tutorials that are more approachable for beginners. And if you like these ideas, yeah, write me what subjects you would like me to touch, what things you struggle with, and I will be really happy to try to help you with this. In the meantime, I wish you a great week, and please stay safe during this COVID situation and use this time to learn more things about Blender. I mean, it's the best thing that you can do at the moment. Really thank you for all of your support, and see you next week.